These dice are rather unusual. They are marked not like ordinary dice 1 through 6, but in various peculiar patterns. For example, this is 3 everywhere. 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3. This one has 4, 4, 4, 4, and 0, 0. Okay, so 4, 4, 4, 4, 0, 0 against 3 everywhere. And we play the following game. Two players roll them against each other. And whichever number comes up higher wins. In this case, this won, this lost. Had it been like this, this would have lost, this would have won. Now, we try to rank the dice. Compare the dice and see, say, which is stronger, which is weaker. And here's the definition. We say that one die is stronger than the other die if that die has a higher probability of winning against the other die, which means that it wins more frequently against the other die, and conversely, one of them is weaker than the other if that loses more often. Let's note that we are not comparing the average scores. We are comparing the probabilities. For example, if you had 3 everywhere and the other die, instead of 4, 4, 4, 0, 0, had, let's say, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, and 10 gazillion, of course, every 3, you know, wins more often. But the one that has 10 gazillion has a higher score, but that's a higher average score, but that's not what we're talking about. We are comparing probabilities of winning. Okay, so which one of these is stronger? You can see that this has 4, 4, 4, 4, 0, 0, and this is 3 everywhere. So clearly, this wins 4 out of 6 times and loses 2 out of 6 times. So this wins more often against this one. So this is stronger than that one. Thus, the beginning of the totem pole ranking is like this. This is stronger than that one. Let's keep the stronger of the two, winner, and compare it against this newcomer. This newcomer has 555 and 111, okay? 555, 111 against 444400. Which one is stronger? Well, it looks like we have to do arithmetic. That would be a bit ugly. Arithmetic may not be so difficult, but we don't want to sort of mess around with calculations. Fortunately, there is a very nifty way of arguing qualitatively and seeing which one is stronger. We argue as follows. You see, this one is half of the time it comes up 5. So suppose that it comes up 5, which happens half of the time. Well, in that case, whatever the other die does, this has won already. Because the other die has only 4s or 0s. So this wins already half of the time. But even if it shows up 1, well, it still has some non-zero residual positive probability of winning if the other one were careless enough to show 0. So it wins 50% plus change, so this is strictly stronger than that one, and that's why this is stronger than the other one. Well, this is a very nice argument because in the definition, we don't really care by how much you win, all you have to know is which wins more often. So we don't have to calculate the exact probabilities. If you can say, well, this wins more often than that, that's the end of the story. So the totem pole continues like this. This one beats this one, and this one beat this one. Okay, now let's compare this winner with the newcomer. The newcomer has 6-6 and 2-2-2-2. 2-2-2-2 and 6-6. Whereas the previous champion was 5-5-5-1-1-1. Which wins more often? Again, it looks like a matter of arithmetic and we wanted to avoid arithmetic. Fortunately, there is a nifty argument which qualitatively decides which one wins more often. And it's the same argument as before, but we apply it to the loser this time. Let's say that this has shown 1. This came up 1. In which case, it's already lost whatever the other die does, because the other die has only 6s and 2s. Okay, so this one has already lost half of the time, at least half of the time. But even if it shows up 5, it still has a non-zero positive residual probability of losing against the other one if the other one were careful enough to show 6 instead of 2. So this one loses 50% of the time plus change, so it loses more often than the other one. So this is weaker than the other one. That is why this is weaker, this is stronger, so this beats this one. So far then, we have seen the following ranking. This beats this, this beats this, this beats this. Yeah. This beats this, this beats this, this beats this. But now let's compare the two ends. This one has 6-6, 2-2-2-2. This was 3 everywhere. Which one wins more often? Of course this one, because this one wins 4 times out of 6 when the other one shows up 2. And loses only 2 times when the other one shows 6 out of 6. So the situation is that this beats this, this beats this, this beats this, but this beats this. There is a cycle, and we call this a non-transitive cycle in probabilistic comparisons. I think that this phenomenon,
which has been known for quite a long time, but deserves to be known to everyone, really all citizens. What we are saying is that, you know, if you are comparing, say, performances of three drugs or something like that, and then you say, well, A cures more people than B in some statistical sample, and in other statistical sample, B cures more people than C, you cannot necessarily conclude that A is better than C. You know, A better than B, B better than C does not necessarily, when you're doing probabilistic comparisons, that A is better than C. It might happen to be true, but we are saying that that's not the logical necessity. And in fact, this example shows that you can't conclude that. Again, I'd like to emphasize that as long as you're comparing the average scores, this kind of phenomenon never occurs, of course, because all the average scores can be ranked in a linear fashion. But if you are comparing which one is more often, there's a lot of conditioning going on, and that is why you cannot so carelessly conclude that A better than B, B better than C means that A is better than C. That's not necessarily true. This is called a non-transitive dice. This kind of situation is called non-transitive probabilistic comparison. When you compare probabilities, you have to be quite careful, and it occurs in all sorts of serious and interesting situations.
These are the minimal amount of symmetry you can have, to be fair, whereas your ordinary cube has excessive amounts of symmetry, you could say, right? I mean, there's extra symmetry. It's like this thing is the same as the same shape, but like it's still phase two.